start with private equity investment. Tell me, Reid, what does that mean?
Well, it means someone comes in and buys a slice of the game. The bit I don't understand about... Look, obviously the game's going through some financial problems at the moment. I think the figures that have been thrown around, $300 million or so, but I'm not sure why you would sell a game from a position of weakness. You know, if you're in a position of strength and you decide to sell a game, I could probably understand it. But at the moment, you know, the game's not exactly in a powerful position. So why would you then go and sell part of it if that was... And look, I'm not sure how advanced it is.
Look, you and I actually wrote about it 3 weeks ago, and the NRL are very, very cold on it. It's being pushed by Bart Campbell, who is the former chairman of the Storm, majority... owner of the Storm. He has tried to distance himself ever since we wrote about it 3 weeks ago that he's got anything to do with it. Those clubs that are dealing with him, and also Matt Tripp, who's the chairman of the Storm, aren't buying that. They presented to the NRL during the week. The NRL are really cold on it. They don't want it to happen. So they seem to think that it's... one, it's risky, but they're worried that the clubs who want the money are going to dive in and are getting interested in it. But I think it's just not going to go anywhere.
Are you in agreement with that?
I just think Peter Volandis has always said he's going to keep one of his
cliches. Primates.
Yeah, his cliches. Yeah.
Well, it is. It's what you're saying.
He's saying that he loves to keep every option open. Yeah. I don't think this option will stay open too long.
Yeah, but when
honestly.
They say that, it's actually we're not interested in
that's
this.
Right.
It's just giving it lip service. So okay. I don't think it's going to happen.
What about Trent Barrett at the Bulldogs? Is that something that is going to happen?
Yeah, it
is
will.
Is it the
happen.
Right choice?
It will happen within the next 48, 72 hours. There's only. Trent has the contract. He's just mulling over a few minor matters on that contract. Is it the right choice? Well, I think it's probably the best choice at this point in time for the Bulldogs. And I say that knowing that a lot of people have said, why aren't they going to get Craig Bellamy? Why aren't they getting Wayne Bennett? Well, those two individuals aren't available and they're not interested in the role. So you need to keep moving on the list. I think Trent has certainly sold his story well and his application well for this job in what he has learned from the mistakes, but also the positives that he had at Manly, and he believes that he can have some impact at the Bulldogs.
Jury's out on whether it's going to be a success or not. I think Baz, by his own admission, made mistakes there in his first year as a coach. It'll be better for the run. He's come back the hard way. He had a year off. He went and worked with the All Blacks for a short time and then, you know, has done wonders with Penrith this year. There's never been any doubting his ability as a football coach. Mm. It's all the other stuff around being a head coach and the politics of being in that role. He couldn't really handle it at Manly, and the big question is how is he going to shut that out at Belmore, where there's politics almost on a daily basis with more than just one faction. But, you know, I'd like to think he can turn it around from what happened at the Seagulls.
I mean, it's a risk, right? But who's not a risk? Mm. Aside from Craig Bellamy, Wayne Bennett, Trent Robinson, everyone's a risk. So, you know, I think he's the best risk they can take. He needs to surround himself with the right people.
That's going
to
be the key. His
assistant
staff.
Coaches. That's going to be
key,
crucial for
sure.
Him. Yeah.
So assistant coaches aside, what about there are calls for Gus Gould to be appointed in some kind of leadership role there? May not work at the moment with the current board and current administration, but it would Gus be right for that
it's
role?
It's not the worst decision. I mean, you know, is there a better football brain in the game? Probably not. He's obviously got a relationship with Wayne Beavis, who's Trent Barrett's manager, so... you know, I assume they know each other pretty well, so it makes a bit of sense.
Gus could do a lot worse. I want to see how Gus handles the politics of Canterbury.
Let's just say this. We can rule out Phil Gould joining the Bulldogs while ever the current board exists. But if there was to be some changes, that's where Gus's name would certainly firm. As the boys have said, that he's a firm supporter of Trent Barrett. We know that he has spoken about that support to some individuals already at Canterbury, that Trent Barrett will be the right choice.
Dean Pay was, well, I say sacked, but he stood down. He was stood down earlier in the week. Mary McGregor at the Dragons, do they need to make a call now on his future?
I don't think so, no. I think that this is what got them in trouble last time around, where they went too early. Some would argue, in extending Mary's contract. Mary's in a vastly different situation to what Dean Pay was in. Dean was off contract this year. Paul McGregor isn't. He's still got 1 year remaining next year. I think they just need to keep doing what they were doing yesterday, just keep winning matches.
I think more the point with Mary is they need to make a decision potentially in the off-season, because we saw what happened. Dean Pay got in the last year of his deal and it became a weekly discussion point whether he was going to get an extension or not. So next year is Mary's last year. In the off-season, if you don't make a call on what you're doing they're going to face that the first 10 weeks. A discussion every week about whether Mary is the right man for the job, whether they extend him or make the decision to move on at the end of next year. So I think the next 10 weeks is crucial for Paul. And then I think they need to make a decision in the off-season.
I agree, but my concern is they're just going to, you know, go along like they have in the last month and beat some of the lower teams and, you know, maybe get near the eight, maybe not. And that'll be enough for the Dragons board that have been apathetic at the best of times to go, you know what, we'll just go another year. Mm. You know, and I just think you need a more proactive board and power brokers at that club prepared to make a hard call that aren't just happy with mediocrity. And that's what concerns me, that I'm not saying they have to spear Mary now. I'm glad that they've won some games, but they haven't really beaten, some... I still think they'll have to make change there at some stage.
Well, what could force the Dragons' hand to making a decision is that other dominoes are going to fall, and the Dragons management will be worried that they may miss the boat on a particular coach that they're after. We know that there could be some movement at other clubs, particularly the Cowboys, and so it's about timing is everything for the Dragons. And Reedy's probably right. At the back end of this year, I think we're going to see a few coaches available, and if the Dragons don't make a call, they could miss out.
Well, what's interesting, at the end of next year, you'll have Craig Fitzgibbon, who seems just the ideal fit for that footy club, Wayne Bennett at the end of next year. Mm. So those blokes come off or are available when Mary comes off contract. So that's what makes it intriguing.
Mm. OK, well, coach movement, player movement. Nick Kotrick, did the Bulldogs rush, do you think, into that signing?
I think it shows you the tale of two clubs. Like, a few years ago, Canberra were desperate and had to pay overs to get, you know, players of that calibre to their club. But the fact that they weren't prepared to go above 500 a year says how strong they are in their beliefs and their philosophies and just their ability to attract players. The fact that Canterbury have paid Nick Kotrick, and there's no disrespect to him, but around 670 in the third year of his deal, he is not on that amount of money. But they have to pay overs to get a player of that ability to their club.
Yeah, I'm concerned about it big time because, as I agree with Webby, it's got nothing to do with Nick Kotrick, the player. He's an Origin player, we get that. But they've already got Dallin Mateni-Zalesniak on big money, upwards of $500,000 at the Bulldogs. You throw Nick Kotrick in that, there's wing and centres on big money. And this is the problem that got the Dogs in trouble in the first place. I think it's too much to pay. Good luck to Nick Kotrick for getting the contract, but I'm worried the Dogs have reacted that they haven't learned anything from their mistakes previously.
Yeah, I'm sort of with that, what you're saying, Dave. I mean, I think the Dragons a few years ago got themselves in trouble because they spent too much money on their wingers. And if Nick's not a centre, and Canberra obviously don't think he is, he's an Origin winger, they end up with Dallin and Nick on the wings. You've got $1.1 million on your wingers. That's how you get yourself in salary cap problems. So, you know, if he doesn't work out as a centre, they're going to have an issue long-term because they've got guys on big money in positions that don't really influence the result. And then they've got their halves, where they've got long-standing problems finding a half.
And hooker.
Hooker. You know, there's positions they need to spend money in. I don't think the outside backs, the wings, are where they need to spend it.
Yeah.
OK, I want to go to you, Brent, because I heard you asking a lot of these questions in the Broncos press. You did very well. It's not easy to do.
He hammered him.
He did. I thought you were very respectful.
Talk about kicking a bloke when he's down.
How would you opened it, Webby, if you were there?
Should you be coaching?
Yeah, that's far less.
They're legitimate questions.
Yeah, that been absolutely.
Asked of Anthony Seibold.
No, they needed to be asked. I want to ask you the situation at the Broncos and the 5 out of the next 10 wins. Is that confirmed? Is it verified? Is it true?
I don't think anyone will confirm that. And, you know, I'd be surprised if they came out and said to Anthony, you've got to win 5 games to keep your job. I would think there's no doubt there's been, I think, a momentum shift there in the past month or so where I think Anthony's hanging on at the moment. I think he needs to finish the season strongly or he'll be gone. I mean, I think it's that simple. I think the board's been behind him, the management's been behind him, but I think they've almost reached the end of their tether. And they're saying now, and I think the understanding is, you need to finish well or this has to end. So I'm not sure if there's an amount of games put on it. I think it's just an understanding things need to really improve.
I thought he looked defeated for the first time in that press conference. Yeah.
Have we worked out whether there's a performance clause or not in that contract?
No.
So there's not?
There's no performance clause in that contract.
So you had Paul White said there is. You've had others say that it's not. You've had Darren Lockyer say that it's not. Does anyone even read the coach's contract at the Broncos or not?
Potentially not.
I mean, seriously. That just sums up the gibber that's going on in the joint.
There's no clauses related to where the side finishes or the amount of wins they have. The clauses are related to whether he's performing his job. That the regulation clause.
So that's
clauses,
a bit subjective, isn't
the
it?
The regulation clause is in anyone's contract. You know, if you're not fulfilling your duties, if you bring the club into disrepute.
Do they define the duties though? Is what they're subjective to?
No lawyer. You couldn't argue in a court. You would not win if you went in a court of law and said we finished with the wooden spoon. He hasn't performed his duties. They wouldn't win that.
Okay.
So there's no clause related to how the team finishes.
Okay. Very quickly before we finish, Cam Smith. Should he retire end of this year?
Well, I think Cam Smith has to put the Melbourne Storm first on this occasion, and he knows Harry Grant's coming back. They've got Brandon Smith already. They need to make... I think he should put the Storm first and call it.
Play on if you can, Cam. Play on. And come back for Queensland, Cam. Please.
Cameron should do whatever Cameron wants.
Well said, Webby. What a way to finish it. Gentlemen, thank you very much for your time.